I recounted to Shalini the other day about my favourite program where Robert Hughes, the art critic, he was the art critic for Time magazine. He did a number of programs on contemporary art. He wrote the book, the important book, The Shop of the New. Maybe you know that book. But in his last program, he was asked, where do you see contemporary art going? How do you see the trends? And he said, I'm not a prophet. And he said, but what I do see is a rush to insignificance. And I think in a way, contemporary jewelry, there is a rush to insignificance. Now, a lot of people will disagree with me. I would upset a lot of people, and some of them are my ex-students, people I dearly love, and this has caused a little bit of a rift because there is a sort of politics going on. Now, I don't think we need to talk about this anymore. But it means that it's a lively room, that's the thing. But if all the goldsmiths die, where is the craft gone? I'll answer my own question. And I see this on the radio today, it's the papers that leave the craft alone. Because you see, I don't know, there are principally three devils that affect the goldsmith. The three devils. The first one is war. War. This is the destruction of the jewelry. The jewelry is destroying war. So it's war. The second one is poverty. What do you do when you lose all your wealth, you have no money, you sell the jewels, you melt them down. So the first one is war, the second one is poverty, and the third one is fashion. Fashion kills the jewelry because they want to change it to the current fashion. And so a lot of jewelry, a lot of wonderful jewelry is lost because the owner, the wearer wants to. It looks old-fashioned, they don't want this anymore, and so they give it to the jewelry, it melts it down and makes a new piece that is relates to the current trend of the day. So war, poverty and fashion, they're the three devils that were set the goals. Now why are we talking about this? Oh, the faker. Yeah, so this is connected in some way. It's just that. Okay, fashion, the last one, fashion. Fashion can be very exciting, very interesting, but it can be also a trend that kills the artists, it can kill the manufacturer. Fashion or trends make other things obsolete or appearing obsolete. So things go out of fashion and people don't make those things anymore, so they lose the ability, they die, all the old shoemakers or goldsmiths, they all die, and so that craft is lost. But there is one saviour. Now, I'm not a great advocate of the faker, but the faker is the one who keeps the craft alive. This has been shown in some historical periods that they've lost the ability to make certain things, but there is a faker who makes these things, and so it still hits the market. And museums have bought these pieces. We won't claim names of museums or the artists, but there have been fakers that have made these. You see, there's very little jewellery, precious jewellery, in the High Renaissance period, where you know it existed. But most of it has been destroyed, been melted. War, poverty and fashion. So it was lost. But oh, I am going to mention that. So there's very little of that material in the museums. And so when a piece from that era, of that stylistic genre, comes along in the market, museums think, oh, that will fill that gap in the museum collection. Now there was a German goldsmith, Reinhold Vasquez. In the 19th century, he was a superb maker. He learned by repairing pieces from the Aachen Cathedral and the V&A in London, the Kunsthistorische in Vienna. There's other collection, major institutions, major collection, they all have Reinhold Pasco's pieces, jewellery of that high Renaissance period. So, I don't think that the fakers are going to be our saviour, but it's interesting how they keep the crafts alive.
You look at someone who is interested in the history of jewelry, so you're competing a lot with museums. In museums, we see archaeological finds that have been promoted. They see the show, they can cut off people. They might be painting an art from the world. But see, in your.
Sorry, I missed that.
They might have been painted in the past.
These are archaeological pieces in museums.
Yeah.
And what, sorry, what are
they? They might have been painted.
Painted.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so but I see from your words, a lot of it is
multi-colored.
Yeah. So is it a conscious decision to paint your
words? No, this is a contemporary. This is contemporary art. You see, like calico, this is an industrial process. The thing is, in jewelry history, if you look at, say, Egyptian, if you look at Etruscan, if you look at early Greek gold jewellery, it's not coloured, it's just the gold. The gold is the colour. This is the important thing. The gold is the colour. And then you come to this late 4th century, this period of Alexander, and that's when the polychrome that they have now is full colour now. So that colour, the ancient Greek goldsmiths, they are, I think they're the pinnacle for superb fine manufacture. And they had such an understanding of the gold that they were able to make really quite wondrous, intricate things. And so that has an energy, that has a vitality, that has a grace. It doesn't need anything else, it doesn't need to be coloured. But certainly, like in other periods, it's the gem, the colour of the gem is the colour of the of the jewelry. In late Renaissance period, when gems became the most important thing, and really the metal was only a vehicle to carry the gem, and the whole fashion was to not see the metal, just to see the gems. And so the goldsmith wasn't able to do really quite complex things. It was really to be a gem hunter. But no, like those pieces that I showed you, this is really about an artistic statement, and that our colour can be imbued with meaning. Colour can be a vehicle for meaning. Colour can be, can expand your subject.
You've mentioned several jewellery ages. You haven't said anything about Scythian or Celtic.
You have some opinion? Scythian jewellery. Scythian jewellery is during that period of Magna Graecia, maybe from the 5th century BC. British Museum have wonderful pieces from Bactria. Scythian, but Scythian were nomadic people, they were horse people, and they're not big. They were goldsmiths. They made wonderful gold. They generally had clasps and things like this. There are some Bactrian bracelets, but Scythian gold work is superb. It doesn't have that fine manufacture of the high Greek the curious thing about the Scythians is that the burial. See, a lot of jewellery is lost in burial, it's found in burial, lost in burial, it's found in burial. And on funerary pyres, a lot of jewellery was damaged because the jewellery was worn on the funerary pyre. And so, but the interesting thing about Scythians, they, when the chief or the leader passed away, they built these the stone walls. It was like a chamber, a bed chamber, and there was a room for this leader and his wife. The wife, she was killed, and she lay beside this dead leader, and then their servants. There was another room where all the dead servants lay, and then there was another room where the horses. lathe and the carriages. We're interested in carriages because it's about horses. There is a wonderful little gold jewellery piece, Syrian, in the British Museum of a little horse-drawn car. But anyway, so I digress. So what they do, so they have all these stone, they've made up all these rooms. And then what do? They have all this earth and they put it over the top. And this creates a building. It's called the tumulus. Because the excavations, you know, in Etruscan tombs, they're in a cliff face or something like this, and the Egyptians in pyramids and things. But the Syrians, and I didn't say this, but the wealth goes with them. And so a lot of tumulus or tumuli have been excavated. They carve away this, what people thought was a hill for 2 millennia, and they find these divisions of stone walls, and they find skeletons with gold, and there's a lot of gold, Scythian gold pieces have been found in that way, been excavated in the eastern Russian steppe, Black Sea region. Wonderful history.